Lord, have your way in us today as we get into a topic that is not that complicated. It's not that difficult to understand. We've seen it perverted so much over the decades, over the years, especially here in this country, that so many people shy away from this thing. The gifts of the Spirit is something that scares people. It scares your people. So just fill us today with this idea of, let's just wipe the slate clean. Let's start from zero. Let's forget what we think we know about this topic, and let's just see what your word says. That's all that matters. Let's drop the baggage. So Lord, I pray that you would speak through me today. I pray that you would give us ears and hearts and a mind to understand, to comprehend, and to apply the simple truth of this notion as presented by Paul as he's teaching those in Corinth. Let him teach us today through the power of your spirits. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen.
Humans have inherently low self-esteem. It may not seem that way because of how self-centered we are. It kind of seems like, hey, we've got it all figured out. We know everything. But, you know, when I look around at people in my life that act that way, they're really covering up the fact that they don't know much at all, and they're very uncomfortable with that. They're actually very uncomfortable with what they do know. And so they try to cover that up by acting more aggressive, more in charge, more on top of things than they actually are. In the flesh, we may pretend that we're pretty awesome, but there's this nagging truth just right below the surface, and we all know it. In the grand scheme of things, individually, we're just not that big a deal. We're really not. When it's quiet and we're alone, we seem to realize that this world kind of happens to us. We don't really happen to the world. We don't change all that many things as individuals. Look at our science fiction stories. You want to know what a culture thinks about things? Look at their media. Look at their entertainment. Look at our science fiction stories. Even back in the 30s and 40s. You know, I love those old-time radio shows. I listen to them all the time. I just listened to War of the Worlds again this week. The original. Yes, Casey, I am that old. All of our science fiction stories are predicated on this idea that some great power from somewhere else comes here either to slap us and stop us from doing something stupid. That's what a lot of those old radio shows are about. It was the beginning of the nuclear age, and a lot of those stories are centered around the fact that some more intelligent power from somewhere else comes here to stop us from blowing ourselves up. Or it's a story about somebody just so overwhelmingly powerful they just come here and take over, or they come here and wipe us out because they want the planet and we're just in the way. All of those stories have us as the little guy, and somebody bigger and faster and smarter and tougher and better equipped comes in and demolishes us. What does that say about us? If that's the way why don't we write stories about us going to Mars and kicking everybody off the planet there? Generally, that's not the way we write those stories. Aliens are always better. The other guy is always better. We're always the underdog. What's the other most popular kind of story that gets told in our culture? Superhero stories. We love those. All kinds of media from comic books to cartoons to movies to books, everything. Superheroes, over. We're just being inundated with that right now. These are completely predicated on the notion that normal humans can't solve any of their own problems. Do you understand that? Why do those stories play so well with us? Why do we eat those up? Because that's what we're feeling inside. This is all way bigger than me. I wish I was on top of it, but I'm not. I'm just a human. I need a superhero. I need some other kind of being with a whole different skill set that I can't develop or attain for myself to come and save the day for me. That's the story all of those follow. Sounds like the gospel to me. Why are those stories so popular? Because there is a hard written code inside of us that we are born with that tells us you need a Savior. You need a power from outside this sphere of influence to come in and save you because you need something you can't get. And that pours out of us in our lost state as stories of other gods or superheroes. Are superheroes not the same thing as like Greek mythology? Yeah. Looking for something to satisfy that urge, to give us a little bit of hope, even though we know it's false. It's something to grab onto. Something to take our focus off of the uneasiness and the fear and the defeatism and the hopelessness that we're consumed by, whether we admit it or not. The depression that just so overwhelms us when we step back and look at how big it all is and how small we all are. Now that makes perfect sense for the lost. We're supposed to feel that way when we're lost. Why? Because that's what the Spirit uses to pull us to Jesus. Hey, I've got your superhero. I've got the real deal. We can end this storyline right now. That's the hope of the gospel. It's supposed to change everything. It makes perfect sense out there. But I see this inside the church. I see this amongst those who have been born again. Amazingly, there's still a lot of uneasiness and fear and defeatism and anxiety and hopelessness and depression, even. Not over a singular event that, you know, we all have things that happen in our life that we grieve over. A singular thing that gives us angst or something we have to deal with. I'm talking about just in general. Like a cloud of depression over our life. For the believer, that should not be. We seem to be saying, I thought everything would be different now. I thought I'd have all the answers now. I thought I'd be able to live and move and power and confidence now. Verse 1, chapter 12. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. Paul knows exactly what I'm talking about. He knows that the people are struggling in this area. And he says, as the teacher, as the pastor, as the founder of this church, he wants the people to walk with power and strength and confidence. He knows there's something available to them they have not been taking advantage of. He says, I don't want you to be ignorant of this. Now, the original language, this word ignorance, it doesn't mean stupid. It doesn't mean unable to understand. It doesn't mean unable to get the knowledge base. It just means you don't have it yet. It literally means not to know. To have no knowledge, to be unaware. It's not a derogative term at all. It just means you haven't learned it yet. Well, what is there to learn? Again in verse 1, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. He says, before being led by your emotions and your understanding and your willingness to follow the crowd and your inability to sense the effect of evil in your life, however you were led, you ended up in situations where you were worshiping false gods, where you had false hopes and false dreams. You were worshiping gods that didn't exist, dumb idols. Since they didn't exist, they couldn't speak to you. They couldn't help you. They couldn't teach you. They couldn't lead you. They certainly couldn't enable you to do anything. There's no power. But know this, Paul says, you have now come to the one true God. Don't put the baggage from that old idea onto this. This is new. The one true God, the one who was and is to come, the one who can speak and can help and can lead and can enable you to do things. This is different than everything else you've ever known. So often we come to Christ and there's a real salvation, there's a real confession, a real profession of faith, or a real repentance, and really coming to Christ. And yet then we try to keep our old life and just take Jesus and put him on that. We got to forget that notion. This is a new thing. If we're going to be a new creation in Christ, we got to wipe away everything we knew before and start over. We're not even relearning. We're learning new, because everything we were following before was leading us away from Christ somehow, one way or another. So don't bring any of that into this. Paul says you used to worship God, you used to pray to God, and you never got any answers. No kidding. But now, you are worshiping God. You're following God in the flesh, Jesus. And there is more available to you now than you ever considered possible. God teaches a foundational precept of true discipleship through James. You know, I love that book. He says in chapter 2, if a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? In the same way, God follows this precept as well. He's only asking us to do things that are in His nature. So when we see Him giving us a command to do something or to think something or to say something, that's His heart and His nature He's trying to pass along to us. It's important stuff. In the same way, He follows this precept with all of us, knowing that He has commanded us to live a certain way and do certain things, and knowing we don't have the ability to do those things on our own. What does He do? Does He just say, hey, go try harder? You'll get it. I believe in you. Go try harder. No, He knows better. He has given us the things we need in order to accomplish all that He has for us. Because that's what kind of God He is. How does He do it? We now have God living inside us. That's what makes this whole thing so radically different than anything we've ever experienced before. He has provided everything that we need. Go back to John with me for a second. John chapter 14. John 14, verse 15. Jesus speaking, if you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and He will give you another Helper, that He may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees Him nor knows Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. This is different than anything else you have ever known. This is not getting cleaned up and acting better and just doing and saying the right things and checking things off a list so that you can be listed as part of this group. This is a new creation in Christ, saved by God, now indwelt by God, the Holy Spirit. Paul says there's evidence of this already, that the Spirit is working in your life. He says, know this, it's impossible to come to a saving knowledge of Christ, the understanding that you need a Savior, that He is that Savior, to the extent that you move beyond an intellectual knowledge of those facts and to the willingness to yield your life to Him. It's impossible to make Him your Lord. We see that word Lord in verse 3. That's kuros in the original language. It means supreme authority. Paul says, here's the evidence that the Holy Spirit is real, that He's already impacted you. I'm telling you, it's impossible, whether you want to or not, it's impossible for you to actually confess Jesus as your Lord and it be true unless the Spirit has revealed that truth to you. So you already have the proof that there is something new going on. He's laying a foundation here that the power of the Holy Spirit is real, that He's active in our lives, and He has specific purpose in our lives. And then He's going to go on and flesh that out here. He's saying if you actually made it all the way to the point where you've truly given your life to Christ because you want Him to be your Savior and your Lord, you are truly saved and you have the Holy Spirit inside you right now and always. Jesus called the Holy Spirit the Helper, who provides conviction when we go astray, strength to overcome when we want victory, leadership in how we're to be involved in the work of the ministry and the specific tools and the skills needed to perform that work. Wednesday night for worship, we did that new Jeremy Camp song, Same Power. I love that song. The chorus, the same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, the same power that moves mountains when He speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us. It's a big deal. What are we afraid of? Why are we meek? Why are we still oppressed by sin and by other people? We're not only saved for eternity out there. We have God in us right now. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, I do not want you to be ignorant. Verse 4, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Don't you zone out on this topic. You think this doesn't apply to you today? Read verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. The Holy Spirit in you is not intended to be dormant, just there to be an alarm when you're about to walk off the edge of a cliff and then just waiting for the next opportunity to do that again. There's stuff to do. He's the one that points us those directions. He's the one that equips us to do those things, that tells us when and how and why sometimes, not always. Diversities of gifts. Several different specific tools and abilities. Differences of ministries. Several different specific missions or types of work that God may use to accomplish His goal, whatever the bigger picture is that we often don't understand. Diversities of activities. Several different ways a specific tool may be brought into play in different situations to accomplish God's work. We have to be careful. We struggle with this one sometimes because we want a checklist. We want a pattern. We want a formula. We want a kneel down and say these words and this happens. It's not the way it's set up. There are some false religions that try to turn it into that. It's not what Scripture says. It's not how it's laid out. The very same gift used for the very same purpose and two different people will hardly ever be manifested in the same way. Why? Because the people are radically different. Because the Spirit works in our lives differently based on our characteristics and our personalities, our tendencies. It's an amazing thing. Our God loves us so much that He always deals with us as individuals. Is there a group, the church, the body of Christ? Yes. But He works in each individual life. On a very personal, very much a one-on-one situation. Therefore, don't ever try to duplicate anything about somebody else's spiritual gift or the way that they use it. And don't use their experiences to evaluate yours or vice versa. Well, I seem to have this spiritual gift. This seems to be the way that God uses me. And I know that He uses her in the same way. I've seen the evidence of that. So, what does it mean when I'm not doing it anywhere near the way she's doing it? She did it this way and an amazing thing happened. I better do it that way. No, that's not how it works. Differences, diversities of tools and opportunities and activities. Individual, this is for each of us to search out on our own. Through prayer, through meditation on the Word, through seeking the counsel of the Spirit. Let's not try to put God in a box by trying to confine Him to a pattern. That's not how it works. Just give Him control. Let go. Enjoy the ride. Remember, it's not about you. It's not about what makes you more comfortable. It's not about the system you like better. It's not your birthday. It's everybody else's birthday. And so how does God want to use you today to bless somebody else? What tools are you going to need to do that? What opportunity is going to have to be presented for you to get the chance to even do it? And how's it going to go once you're there? All of that's out of your control. Now, our flesh doesn't like not being in control. We should get very comfortable with that. Why? Because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead living in us. It's okay. He's trustworthy. You can let go and let Him do whatever He wants to do. Just give Him control. Back to verse 7. But the manifestation of the who? Not the manifestation of Kent? Not the manifestation of Nick or Casey or Graham? Again, our flesh is like, well, I want to be in control. I love verse 7. Why? It takes all the weight off my shoulders. What is my job in the whole scenario? I don't know. There's lots of stuff that needs to be done. Lots of different ways to do it. There's a lot of choices to make. But none of those choices are mine. What's my choice? Lord, what do you want me to do today? Pretty much where my responsibility ends. Then I'm just supposed to listen and follow. And He takes care of that. Verse 8, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Lots of different things need to be done. There are lots of different ways to get those things done through lots of different people. But the only responsibility we have is, Lord, what do You want me to do today? He provides the opportunity. He provides the tools. He provides the ability to use the tools. And so the outcome is between God and whomever He's speaking to through us. Whoever He's ministering to. See, that's the tough part too. We can make the mistake of not yielding to Him in the first place, not allowing Him to work through us, because that gets scary sometimes. Sometimes when we get beyond that, and we're like, okay, do what you got to do. Do what you want to do. I'm here. Use me however you want. But then it doesn't go the way we wanted. We don't deal with that very well either. And part of that is just our love for the people He's trying to minister to. And part of it is, I said, we have to allow Him to totally be in control. A lot of times He just says, say this, and walk away. I'm not very good at that. I'll be honest with you. Because I like logic. I'm a guy. I'm a problem solver. I'm a fixer. When you tell me that's broke, I want to pull out the duct tape and fix it. And move on to the next problem. The problem in ministry is, and you are in the ministry, go listen to last week's teaching if you need to hear that. Not just me, you are in the ministry. The problem with the ministry is a lot of times you put the duct tape on there and they rip it back off. I don't want that. Are you kidding? I said, it's hard. That part's out of our control. We can't have any judgment for them. We can't make the decision for them. We will be held accountable for our choices with what He has for us to do, what He has for us to say, where He wants us to go, how He wants us to act. And they will be held accountable to Him for their reception of that. I've been in situations where, honestly, I've had a bad attitude about that. I just gave you everything you needed to fix this problem. I offered to help, and you rejected it. Man, that ticks me off. Well, who am I? What does it matter if I'm ticked off? Should it be trying to please me in the first place? No. Because I've seen that too. I've seen people, okay, I'm going to do that. And every time I see them, they're like, hey, I'm doing this. But they can't keep it up because they still don't have the heart of repentance and restoration. And so what good did I accomplish by guilting them into doing that either? My job is to love people. And if that includes an exhortation, an encouragement, a word of truth for them to help them fix a problem that desperately needs to be fixed, then I should deliver that. And I should hug them. I should tell them, hey, I'm here if you need me. And then I should go on to whatever the next thing is. And if he leaves me back there, okay. But if not, okay. It's not my call. And I'm not responsible for how that turns out. So often we try to carry more of the responsibility than he's even asked us to carry. Since we know we aren't the big deal, and because we remember with the help of the devil all the mistakes we have made before, a lot of times we just step around opportunities altogether. I can't even deal with that today. I'm having trouble getting myself dressed, much less fixing your box. I'm leaving my duct tape at home. What's the problem with those thoughts? It's logic. It's the word we and I used over and over and over instead of he and you and him. Because this is what he's doing, not us. Well, you can't put our limitations on God. I know I can't handle that today. But if he told me to do it, what's he saying? I got you. We're doing this. You can. I've equipped you to do it. I'm going to provide the opportunity. I'm going to provide the ability. I'm going to provide the tools. And if you choose not to do it, that's on you. Not me and not the person you were supposed to be trying to help. You and I are going to deal with that, he has to say to me sometimes. Don't put yourself in that position. What about the specific gifts that are talked about here? The word of wisdom. That's the proper application of knowledge. You gain knowledge. Knowledge are facts. That doesn't mean you know how to use them in a wise way. A way that is fruitful. How to apply what we've learned from Scripture. The ability to answer complex questions in a way others can understand. The ability to give solid advice. Passing on what we've already been taught. The ability to settle disputes in a way that seems right to both sides. That's a gift from God through the Holy Spirit. A word of wisdom. What about the word of knowledge? That's a bit of information that you didn't know, given to you supernaturally, right when you needed it. No other explanation than it came from God. It often happens without any warning. Sometimes I have been in conversations with people and I've said things I didn't even know why I was saying them, and the response on their face is like, "Who told you about that?" I don't know. I still don't know what we're talking about. Word of knowledge. I've got a good friend that I used to go to church with, and this guy came hardwired from the factory with this. You know, there's a problem in thinking of the spiritual gifts in a way. It's like, okay, this one is yours, and that's yours. That's yours from now on. I don't think that's true at all. I don't think Scripture bears that out at all. I think in the situation, he gives us what we need for that situation. The next time, it may be different. But I know a guy who has been given this word of knowledge in a scary way. Man, people cannot lie to this guy. I've been in places where somebody was trying to give him some tall tale, and he'll just stop and he'll say, "That's not true." Something there was no way for him to have a clue what they were talking about. Maybe somebody he didn't even know. "That's not true. Why don't you just stop now and share the truth with me?" Meg, that can rattle somebody. And you know what? Sometimes we need to be rattled. So don't be surprised if in a conversation with somebody who's struggling, if God gives you something to share with him that rattles them, and don't be surprised if it happens to you. It's a good thing. This is God working through his people, trying to bring everybody into line, into the fullness of what he has for us. You know, we saw this with Jesus a lot. He always had the ability to turn things around on those guys that were trying to trip him up with those ridiculous questions. So often he wouldn't even answer the question. He would say, let me ask you this. And the question he asked would seem unrelated to that one, and yet we know that it is, and it actually got to the heart of the problem that the person asking had. It made them deal with something, put them at a point where they had to make a decision as to who they were going to be. Force people to make an important decision, dealing with the actual problems. What about faith? We don't consider faith a gift. We consider faith something we're supposed to grab, something we're supposed to work on. I've got to do better at believing Jesus. I read that in Scripture, but I'm not really sure that I have bought into that. I've really got to buckle down and believe that. I've got to have the faith to follow that. It's not how it works. It's listed here under the gifts, just like all the other abilities we don't have that we need in certain situations. In Hebrews it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's the ability to believe the gospel, which although we know it to be true because we've been gifted by faith by the Holy Spirit, it can't be proven until we die. That's how faith works. Knowing something is true that there is no way you can witness, no way you can see it until after the fact. Important to remember that this ability is a gift from God, distributed to each of us individually as He wills. That's what He already told us. That means it's something we could be praying for, something we can be asking for. All of the gifts are like that. We're not going to get there this week, but Paul will later say, earnestly seek the best gifts. Well, which ones are the best ones? Depends on what situation you're in, but faith is always important. You should be asking for more faith. Why? Because the more we trust His Word, the more we trust His leading, the better off we're going to be, and the better we're going to be for everybody else. It's powerful and life-changing. Faith is what brings all the rest of the things into the proper perspective, and I don't think He can give us any of the others without. If you don't believe in healings or tongues or any of these other gifts, He's not going to use those through you. So you're hampering your effectiveness. What about gifts of healings? There's a plural there, S. So this isn't specifically the gift of, which I don't see evidence of, where somebody is given the ability at will, whenever they want to go to somebody and say, you are healed. I don't care how many times you've seen that on TV. There are a lot of guys that have made a lot of money doing that. And a lot of them have been exposed as fakes. So a lot of people, especially in this area of the country where a lot of that seems to have come from, just back away from that. All looks fake to me. Well, that was fake. But is Scripture fake? Scripture says there's gifts of healings. What does that mean? That means when you're sick, pray for healing. When you run across somebody else who's sick, pray for healing for them. It's a Scripture. We cling to Scripture. In James chapter 5, it says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. If you don't believe that happens, pray for faith. What about miracles? That's something else we don't see a ton of in this country anymore. Supernatural events, both big and small, that can't be explained by any other means than the power of God is being displayed. We see that a lot in other areas of the world right now. People that are just now coming to Christ, they're not carrying all the baggage of negative feelings and having seen all the fakes and all of the you got to prove that to me attitude that Americans have. There's other places in the world that don't carry that baggage, and God is throwing miracles at them to get people's attention and to draw them to Him so they can be saved. It does happen here. It's usually a way for God to get the attention of somebody to draw them to Him. It's not really meant to sustain your faith. It's not really intended to be the thing that sustains your desire to follow Christ. That's not what it was for when Jesus came the first time. It was meant to give validity to His message. And God still uses it much in the same way. Back when I thought I was a believer and I wasn't, and I didn't make this connection immediately, but later on, looking back, I did. I was in a horrific motorcycle wreck one time. And I didn't get hurt very bad, but it was extremely scary. Okay, my brother and I had built this little trailer to pull behind this motorcycle. And I was going to go out and test drive it, make sure the bike would actually pull the trailer with the gear in it. We were going to go camping, right? And so I get out on the little parkway kind of thing around my hometown, and I get up to about 45 miles an hour, and it starts shimmying a little bit. I slowed back down, it stopped. Back up to 45, no problem. Go up to 50, starts shimmying a little bit. Slowed down, it went away. Back up to 50, no problem. Got up to 55, it started shimmying a little bit. I slowed down, it didn't go away. It didn't go away at all. And so I started slowing down. And the slower I got, the more it started doing this. And this bike had crash bars on it. And by the time I got down to about 20 miles an hour, this thing is slamming the ground. And sparks are flying off of those bars. It scared me to death. So it's bam, blam, blam, blam. Dana's following me in the car. And she's seeing all of this happen. It's like 9 or 10 o'clock at night. Not many people around. And she's seeing the fireworks, you know. I rode it as long as I could, and then I tried to jump away from it. Well, the bike stayed attached to the trailer, and it jackknifed and slid up under a guardrail. I ended up on my side underneath the trailer, which only stood about this far off the ground. So I was holding the entire weight of that trailer on my side. My helmet had come off. I wasn't hurt, but my helmet had come off in there, and you know, I'm pretty disoriented. But all I can hear is Dana screaming at the top of her lungs, "Somebody help!" And like three or four other people had stopped, but nobody's doing anything. They're all just standing there. And I realized that the way that thing was pushing down on me, I couldn't expand my chest to take a breath. And there was no way for me to get out from underneath there. I used the last breath I had to say, "I can't breathe." And I don't know what the trailer weighed. Okay, here's the stupid part of the story. My brother and I had this great idea to build a trailer for my motorcycle. It was 6 feet long and about 3.5 feet wide. I wanted to be able to carry my drum set in it. That was the plan. This thing is substantial, okay? It was built on the axle of a little front-wheel drive car, okay? She reached down and picked that thing up off of me and saved my life there that night. It's a miracle. You can tell me about, you know, what's the chemical that gets released? Adrenaline? Yeah, I get that. That's real. I understand that. This thing weighed several hundred pounds. There ain't enough adrenaline in that girl to pick that thing up off the ground. Still attached to the bike. So it was the full weight of the trailer. There was no, "Hey, we're going to rock it on the axle." No, she picked that thing up off the ground. That's a miracle of God right there. There's no other explanation for that. I used to kind of wreck cars as a hobby. I totaled a few. There were three or four times I should have been seriously hurt or died. And it wasn't until I became a believer and started looking back over that the Spirit kind of revealed that to me. It was like, "He was keeping you around. You got something to do." So it all makes sense now. I believe in miracles. I believe God can do whatever He wants to do anytime that He wants to. I believe in miracle healings. We've experienced that here in this building. With people and with dogs, if you haven't heard that story. I believe in all this stuff. Why? Because it's in Scripture, and He's already given me enough faith to believe that if Scripture says it, that I know it's true. And yet, after I believe by faith, He's shown me all these things. That's proof. Giving me stories that I can share. He's given you stories that you can share. This is powerful stuff. Paul spends a lot of time on this. We'll finish up the gifts here in a second, but there's a twofold importance to this. One is we need this power in our life. We need to allow God to do what He wants to do for our blessing. But this is all intended. Everything the Holy Spirit does is to draw people's attention to Jesus. He intends to use all of these things so that we will be blessed and a blessing to those around us. Extremely important. Why don't we see more of those miracles today? Well, for one thing, like I said, it's mostly for unbelievers to get their attention. And it requires faith. Faith which we sometimes lack. And we see that in Scripture too. We looked at this back when we studied Matthew in chapter 13. It says, when He, Jesus, had come to His own country, He taught them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas and his sisters? Are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at Him. They didn't believe. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and his own house. Here's the verse that matters there. Now He did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. What did Jesus say over and over and over? All those miracles that He did, all the healings, all of that stuff. What did He always say to the person? Your faith has made you well. Because of your faith, I'm doing this thing. Believe. Next gift, prophecy. That can be foretelling, telling something that's going to happen in the future. We see a lot of prophecies like that in Scripture, but can also be forthtelling. That's what we call it. It's a word we made up. Just kind of the speaking of God's truth. This gift will provide the knowledge of what's to be conveyed, the wisdom to convey it in the right way and at the right time, and the boldness to stand up and speak. Because that's not always easy to do in a culture that doesn't accept what we had to say anymore. They will listen to anybody but us. So it takes the faith to believe that God equips us to do this in order to carry out this gift as well. This could be to a group, like I'm doing for you right now. It could be to an individual in a conversation you're having. And it's another good reason to know this Scripture well, to know God well, so that you can be more easily emboldened by Him to step out there and say what needs to be said. The discerning of spirits. Imagine you're hearing somebody trying to speak, somebody else trying to speak some truth to you, or you're trying to speak some truth to somebody else, or you're feeling a supernatural leading to believe something or to do something or to go somewhere. Here's a really important question to ask before the train leaves the station. Sometimes we get caught up in the moment and somebody says something, we're like, yeah, and we just go. It's good to have a pause there for a second and ask the question before we accept anything. What's the question? Where's this information coming from? Scripture warns us that demons can masquerade as angels of light. They can share false information. They can't make us do anything. But sometimes they're given the access to speak. Sometimes, even though we're believers, what do? We slip back into that old flesh, the old attitudes. Sometimes that governs what we say or where we go or what we believe. Is this information or leading coming from my spirit, the flesh, what it would like to be true? Is it coming from Satan or is it coming from the Holy Spirit? That matters. That matters. There's a gifting available to be able to discern this, to answer this question, to judge rightly with what the source of something is. Go over to Acts for a second. Chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, verse 14. Now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who, when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, Simon is a sorcerer that lived in that area, okay? Not Simon Peter, but Simon the sorcerer. When he saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Holy Spirit." Now, that kind of sounds like a good thing. Now, the money thing, okay, maybe he just doesn't know any better, but he wants the power of the Holy Spirit. Wouldn't it be better for everybody to have it? Absolutely, would be our logic, or it might be the leading of Satan, might be the leading of our flesh. Verse 20, "But Peter said to him, 'Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness, and pray to God, if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and bound by iniquity.'" Peter knew a lot more about this guy than this guy had told him. Peter understood the motivation behind the question. Asking for a good thing, but asking with the wrong motivation, the wrong heart. And Peter was given the ability in that moment to understand that and to deal with it. Prophesy. Speak truth. But in the right way. Steadfast, but not saying, "Just get away." Why don't you repent and come to Christ? Pray that He might forgive you. That's how that gift is supposed to work. What about tongues? And we are scared to death of tongues. Why? Because we've seen silliness on TV. Straight up blasphemous silliness. But counterfeiters don't make $3 bills for a reason. You don't counterfeit something that's not real, because then everybody knows it's a fake. The fact that that is being counterfeited on TV and in big meetings around the country shows that it is real. Why would the enemy mess with it? It wasn't real. It's in Scripture. It's real. Have I experienced it? No, I have not. Have I asked to? Yeah, I think it'd be awesome. He hasn't seen fit to do that, and it is His will that these gifts get distributed. So I keep asking, and maybe at some point He will. What does it actually mean? Don't get freaked out by what you've seen. What does it mean? It just means the ability to speak in a language you don't understand. That's all it means. We saw it at the day of Pentecost when Peter gives the first sermon there, and you got this big crowd of people, and they gather around, and all the apostles are sharing stuff and sharing truth, and Peter is preaching this sermon, and all of the people that were there from all these different areas all heard that sermon in their own dialect. He's speaking once, and they're all hearing their own dialect. It's the gift of tongues. Pastor Chuck, I heard a story that he told. He's talking about back when Calvary Chapel was small, like this size. He said they were at a meeting one day, and he said things were more casual back then. A lot of times after the service, we would just sit around and see if the Lord wanted to say something, or wanted it kind of like we do in an afterglow here now. And he said we were doing that, and this lady stood up, and she started speaking in this beautiful French. And he said, "I know Latin, and there's some correlation there, so I don't understand French, but I was picking up a word here and there." And she was talking about a song that she had been given and what a praise of God it was. And she just went on and on. And then Pastor Chuck's wife, Kay, stands up. And she starts giving the interpretation of what the lady is saying. Now the cool thing is, neither one of them know French. The next gift is interpretations. What good is a message if nobody can understand it? So the one lady is given a language. It turned out not to be something that nobody understands. It was French. How do we know? Because there was a lady there visiting that day, a lost lady, who had just spent 5 years in France. And she didn't understand why it was such a big deal. that this lady was speaking in French and this lady was explaining it to everybody. She didn't understand why it was being done. She didn't see the purpose in it. The purpose ended up being so that she could see a work of God there that day, and she got saved about a week later. So there is a purpose for all of these things, and it's always about pointing people to Jesus, and none of it is anything to be scared of. It's not about us. It's about Him doing whatever He wants through us. Amen? Now, this is a partial listing of some of the abilities given to God's people. There's some more stuff in Romans 12. You want to look more into that. If you really want to go deep on it, this is a fantastic book. You're welcome to borrow this one if you will bring it back. This book is important to me. I like it. And you'll have to deal with all my little highlights and notes and stuff that won't make any sense to you at all, if you could even read my writing. But this is a fantastic book specifically about the Holy Spirit, the work of the Spirit in the life of the believer. It's in great detail. Chuck was a great, gifted, brilliant writer. I listened to his teaching. I love that, but his book's phenomenal. So if that is a topic you're interested in going deeper on, I highly recommend that. You can get that for free on the internet in PDF format. You don't even have to buy it. It is available to buy. If you want to buy a copy, let me know, and I can get that at a discounted rate for you. We've looked at a partial listing of some of it today, but here's the high points. Think about the gifts and pray that God would use those in your life to be a positive influence on others, to be a positive influence on you. But remember these things. There's nothing here to be scared of. So whatever fears or anxieties you may have about this, that's baggage that you're bringing to the table. Drop that. Let it go. Next thing to remember, verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Why should you study this? Because this applies to you. Why should you pray about this? Because this applies to you if you're a follower of Christ. Scripture says it. We believe it. Verse 11 is the other thing. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Next week we'll look a little more at that part of the concept, how it's also important not to just allow the Spirit to provide these gifts, but really to follow all of His leading in this, because He has a master plan, and there is a big picture that we're not aware of. And so often He will ask me to do this. I don't really care for that. I like this better. This is way more fun for me. So He probably wants me to do that. So next week we'll talk about the mistakes that we can make in that and how to not fall into that trap. And we'll continue on the next couple of chapters. This is going to be talking about the Holy Spirit a lot. So gear up for that. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for Your Word. I thank You for this power that we have. I thank You for the fact that Christianity is different. It is not about us getting better. It's not about us cleaning ourselves up. It's not about us hunkering down and getting more serious about what we do so that we can be more effective. Christianity is about yielding our lives to the one true God, the one of all those out there that the people worship, the one God who can answer back, who can speak truth into our lives, who loves us back when we love Him, and who guides us and who has provided all of the tools, all of the help, all of the opportunities that we are going to need to live a life of close discipleship, of close following of Jesus Christ, which is what we desperately need. So Lord, I pray that You would free us from any preconceived notions that we have. I pray that You would free us from any fears, any anxieties, any worries that we have in this area. And I pray that we could reach a point where we are so comfortable just allowing You to do what You want to do, that amazing things happen in our lives and the lives of those around us as You show Yourself to others through us. Lord, let it be. Let nothing hinder that. I pray against the attacks of the enemy, which will come immediately. As soon as we leave this place, there will be seeds of doubt planted. There will be knowledge here that the enemy will try to steal away before it can be put into practice. And in the name of Jesus, we pray against that. Lord, have Your way. Gift us with knowledge on this subject. Gift us with wisdom on how to use it. And Lord, have Your way in our lives. Your will is perfect. We love You. We praise You. It's in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Love y'all.